Welcome to worship on this beautiful sunny Sunday morning. And I guess it's considered to be 4th of July weekend, although it's not till the Tuesday. But I'm glad to see each and all of you. We'd like to begin with a choral intro, which is a special song to invite the presence of God here in our midst. We have been singing Open Our Eyes during this season. So please let us unite our voice together and sing this song. Please remain seated.
Join me in the call to worship is found on your screens. It is a call and response, so I will read the light print, and if you will respond with the bold print. Come to the mountain of God.
The place of God's holy presence.
No matter how steep the climb,
God journeys with us and helps us along the way.
And if you'll pray the opening prayer with me, let us pray. God of ages past and days yet to come, journey with us today. Journey with us all our days, whether on treacherous paths or beside still waters. Guide our steps to find solid ground, that we may know the firm foundation of your constant presence. Open our minds to the blessings and miracles we encounter along the way. In your holy name, amen. And our opening hymn this morning is Maker in Whom We Live. You'll find the words on your screen. If you're worshiping with us in the sanctuary this morning, it's also in the hymnals in your pews on page 88. And if we can stand as able as we sing this morning.
Thank you.
Well, that's one of the Charles Wesley hymns, beautiful tune, powerful words. So I hope that you remember and sing our voices together. So good morning once again. Good to see each and all of you. Are you guys all right? It looks like the energy level is kind of low or something, but maybe it's a holiday weekend or maybe it's the heat. I don't know. But it is always a blessing for all God's people to be together in worship, praying together, singing together, and we are able to share our joys as well as our concerns together. So we go to the time of prayer, but starting today with doing things a little differently. I'm all for, trying new things, whatnot. Whenever Reverend Charles does the prayer for the people, here in this place, he always asks for the joys, concerns, whatnot. So we like to kind of try that and see that we have a time to share what's happening in our life. But anyway, before I open up the room, I wanted to kind of keep you updated on a few individuals. Please continue to remember Kim Renner as she remembers her mom. Her funeral is going to be, Loretta, her mom's funeral is going to be a week from tomorrow. But it's in Stafford, Virginia, so I'm not sure how many of you are able to actually make it. But if you are interested, I already sent one notice out. But if you'd like to know the exact address again, please reach me. I'll send you the address. The next person I'd like you to ask for prayer is Jesse Winslow. He was here last Sunday worshiping with us, but he had another health scare this past week. Making a long story short, he is back at the house under the hospice care. So he will be there as long as the Lord has for him. But anyway, the family is said to me it's okay to share that, and the family also said that any of you would like to stop by to say hello and to pray with him, to just hug him, whatever, the family will welcome to do you're more than welcome to do so. So I just wanted to pass down the word from the family. Please remember Jan, Julie, and all the family in your prayers. So any other prayer matters that you'd like to share? If you are... Yes?
Pray for Larry Edmondson because he's having problems with his leg.
Okay. Okay, thank you, Ed. So prayer for Larry Edmondson for his legs. And by the way, if I kind of repeat, that's for the people that are streaming, so just so you know. Okay, Dixie?
My friend Linda Clam had heart surgery this week. She had a stent put in. They also had to go into her stomach because she had some bleeding. She's home. She's doing okay.
Yeah.
But if you keep her in her prayers, because she also, they're talking about maybe having to put in another stent.
Okay. So Dixie's friend Linda, please remember her with all the health challenges that they have. I mean, she has. Any others?
Sure.
Ed is back in the church after helping another church for a couple months. Anything else? Any exciting thing happening in your life? Or yes, Ginger.
An irregular heartbeat, and I had a stress echocardiogram on Friday, and I am 100% okay.
Oh, that's wonderful. For those who are streaming, Ginger just shared that she had gone through some tests and everything is good. Thanks be to God. Thank you, Ginger, for sharing that. Others? Well, I just pray for if you are traveling for the next few days, please be safe on the road. And I hope that you, all of you, have a blessed time of celebrating the 4th. So I'd like to begin our prayer time together by quoting this. This is a prayer for the Independence Day found in the United Methodist Book of Worship. So I'd like to begin with that and then we would go to that time of prayer. So now please, open our hearts and join one another in prayer. Let us pray. Looking graciously, O God, upon this land, where it is in pride, subdue it. Where it is in need, supply it. Where it is in error, rectify it. Where it is in default, restore it. Where it is, it holds to that which is just and compassionate, support it. Oh God, we give you thanks on this beautiful Sunday morning when you have called all God's children of all walks of life, that we are able to come together as one heart and one mind, praising your name and being thankful to your wonderful grace and committing our lives to love you and all our neighbors. So we just ask that your presence to be upon us. May the power of the Holy Spirit come upon each and all the persons here and those who might be worshiping at other places. Strengthen us, comfort us, so that we will continue to live the life of faith, trusting in Jesus and his love each and every day. And God, we lift up all those prayer concerns, joys, all the things that we have in our hearts to you, trusting that you receive and you would answer them in your special ways, in your timely manners. And God, we continue to lift up Greenwood Church and each and all the persons in all the ministries of this church. May all we do be pleasing to your eyes. God, we especially lift up the Vacation Bible School that is coming up. May you give the wisdom and discernment to all the adult leaders as they prepare for children to come to this place to learn about Jesus and his love. And I just ask that you bless each and all the kids who will be coming learning about you and your love. Guide us through today and every day so that we will continue to become the people that you have called us to be. Thank you for your grace and your guiding hands. So now the people of God, let us pray together the Lord's Prayer, the prayer Jesus told us to pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, power, and glory forever. Amen. So now I'd like to invite each and all of you to stand as you're able. And may we together recite the Apostles' Creed. It is a statement of our faith, and it, as a Christian person, but also United Methodist Christians. So words be on the screen, or if you'd like to follow with the hymnal, it's in 881, towards the very back of the hymnal. May we together say what we believe. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day, he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and a life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. So now we come to the time in worship when we share special things happening in our lives. Tammy, would you like to say about this, the first one?
Just wanted to say a huge thank you to everyone who met at First Presbyterian to pick up the Vacation Bible School decorations. The picture with Margie, they were calling for heavy storms that day, and Margie told me that she was praying all day, and I was praying all day that it would just hold off long enough to get the decorations from that church into this church so that they didn't get ruined. And I took a picture of her with the blue, beautiful blue skies behind her, just proof that God answers our prayers. So thank you to everyone for your help.
And hold on, can you go to the next one? And if you'd like to say that also.
Any help that we can get next Saturday, July 8th at 9 o'clock. I know that there's a trustees meeting at 9:30, but I don't think that we will interrupt that meeting. We are going to turn the sanctuary into outer space, and all the help that we can get would be much appreciated. The more help, the lesser time we will be here. And if you have any questions, please don't hesitate to reach out to me.
Thank you so much. So if you are able to help this coming Saturday at 9 o'clock, please come, and we're going to together turn this place into space. How exciting is that? So, all right, thank you so much, Tammy. Let's move on to the next pictures. It came from Chuck, Snow, and Uy. They are on vacation. There are some of the actually earlier part of the trip. I think I have seen my new ones, but so they seems to be having a wonderful time. So I just wanted to share that with you. Next one, I would like to invite Miss Beverly to come. Yes, she can talk.
Well, we were actually staying on the shores of Lake Ontario, one of the Great Lakes bordering New York. We were with friends who had a home on the lake. We did a lot of walking along the lake shore, not a whole lot of sand, lots of rocks, beautiful water. We did a couple of other interesting things. We did a few fun things, but basically we did a whole lot of nothing, and it felt wonderful. And if you ever get a chance to go to the western region of New York, take it. It is totally opposite of what you see in New York City. I was told that several times. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Beverly. And the next picture is from me. Me and Josh got to visit D.C. This past week. And we just kind of really dropped in and stay in one place for half an hour and go to another one, whatnot. So we end up going, African-American art or African art, air and space, of course, natural science, and Galilee, National Galilee. So it was good. Anyway, question. Can you guess how big that painting is? It's a Washington. Any guesses? Yeah, it's big. All right, move on to that. That's pretty big. It's, yeah. So you can tell that Josh on the bottom, I just left him so you can see the size comparison kind of thing. So it's a massive photo, paintings. But we had a wonderful time. It was a little warm, but we had a lot of fun, as we always do. All right, Ashley, tell us.
So we went to Baltimore this weekend, Mom, Dad, and I. We stayed Friday night, so we went to the game Friday and Saturday. As you can see in the bottom right-hand corner, Friday night was a concert series night after the game. The game was in rain delay, so the concert didn't start till about 11 at night. But we got to see Shaq, the basketball player, as a DJ. So he DJ'd some music for us, and we had a fun time. And then we went to the game. The Friday's night's game was a floppy hat night, so you can see Dad in the top there. He has his floppy hat on that we all got. And then Saturday was Hawaiian shirt day. And we can flip to the next one because we had some friends there.
We decided impulsively to go to the game, and I just texted Ashley because I knew she's an O's fan, and we found out we were at the same game, so it was a lot of fun.
Yeah, that's cool. Did you stay for the concert too?
This was Saturday, so yeah.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Gotcha. All right. Well, thank you, guys. Glad you had a good time. So the next picture was came from Julie yesterday. So this is yesterday afternoon. I mentioned that during the prayer time. I just asked that you will continue to lift up Jesse, Betty, Julie, Jan, and all the family in your prayers at this time. So we're going to go back to some scheduling, the upcoming events. Tammy, would you like to say more about Bible school?
We're still taking registration forms, And I want to encourage everyone, you don't have to come all five nights. If your children can only come one night or two nights, that's perfectly fine. We will be having registration at 5:45, and the closing is at 8. So if anyone has any questions, you're more than welcome to come and see me. We are also looking for adult volunteers. If you are willing to volunteer the week, then get with me, and I can let you know where we need you.
All right. Thank you. And last but not least, Ms. Heather, would you like to say about White Elephant?
We are so excited about the White Elephant auction coming up on July 30th at 1 o'clock. We hope that all of you will be able to join us for that. It's a lot of fun. If you have any items you'd like to donate to the White Elephant, you can bring them and drop them off downstairs in the Green Sunday School room. We ask that you bring them wrapped and labeled as to the category to which they belong. On the 30th, we will have finger foods for refreshment. So we ask if you come, if you would consider possibly bringing some finger foods to share with the rest of the attendees. And we have some other surprises up our sleeves. It's a lot of fun. We're really excited about it, and we hope that you all can come and join us.
Thank you. So if you have any pictures to share, please send them to me directly, or you may use the church's email, umcgreenwood@gmail.com. Thank you very much. So go ahead, Mr. Steve.
Thank you. Good morning, children. Come on up. How are we this Independence weekend? Hey, this way. Come on. How we doing today? It's good to see you. Come on, let's go up here. I need y'all's help this morning. I am going to talk about something very, very bad. Okay? And so when I say the word, get over here, Lucas. You don't need to be way over there. Come on. We don't bite. When I say the word jealous, I want you all real loud to say, bad. Can we try it? Jealous.
Bad.
Let's try it one more time. Jealous.
Good job.
As loud as you can, because being jealous is very bad. In our scripture this morning, we're talking about David, and Saul was very jealous. Saul was very jealous. All at once. Saul was very jealous.
Bad.
Thank you. Saul was very jealous. Of David, okay? As a matter of fact, he was so jealous because Saul was king, but he wouldn't do what God wanted him to. So God said, "Hup, you're no more king." So they made David king. David's just this young kid about your age, and they made him king. But Saul didn't like that, and Saul became jealous.
Bad.
That's better. As a matter of fact, he was so jealous, he wanted to kill David. And David, they thought, was in a cave. And so Saul and his army went in the cave to kill David, but David wasn't there. And then Saul had to go number one. We know what that is, okay? So he went over by himself, and David snuck in the cave. And guess what he did? He wanted to, but he listened to God. And so he snuck up behind Saul, and he took his sword, and he cut a piece of his garment, a piece of his cloak off. And when Saul came out of the cave, David is standing there going, "Ha, ha, 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 I could have killed you, but God does not want me to be jealous. He wants me to be good. So just know that I have the power to do that, but God doesn't want me to." And so then everybody was scared of David and not jealous. Good job. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, help me not to be jealous. And help me love everyone. Amen. Let's go to Children's Church.
Thank you very much, Mr. Steve. So here's a quick reminder that your giving might be mail to church or online portal, always open. Or if you are worshiping in the house, please place your gift at the offering plate that is in the back of the sanctuary. Now let us pray together as we give back those gifts to the Lord. Let us pray. Oh God, we give you thanks for the many gifts that you give in many different ways. It is time for us to bring those gifts back to you. We pray that you accept our gifts, bless our gifts, and use our gifts for your glory. In Christ's name, we pray. Amen. All right, so now as we prepare to hear the word, please join me the prayer for illumination, which you see on the screen. Let us pray. Lord, open our hearts and minds by the power of the Holy Spirit, that as the scriptures are read and your word is proclaimed, we may hear with joy what you say to us today. Amen.
Good morning. Today our scripture lesson comes from 1 and 2 Samuel. The Lord said to Samuel, "How long will you grieve over Saul? I have rejected him for being king over Israel. Fill your horn with oil and set out. I will send you to Jesse the Bethlehemite, for I have provided for myself a king among his sons." Samuel said to Jesse, "For all your sons here," and he said, "There remains yet the youngest, but he is keeping the sheep." And Samuel said to Jesse, "Send and bring him, for we will not sit down until he comes here." He sent and brought him in. Now he was ruddy and had beautiful eyes and was handsome. The Lord said, "Rise and anoint him, for he is the one." Then Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him in the presence of his brothers. And the Spirit of the Lord came mightily upon David from that day forward. Samuel then set out and went to Ramah. David went out and was successful wherever Saul sent him. As a result, Saul set him over the army, and all the people, even the servants of Saul, approved. Saul was afraid of David because the Lord was with him and had departed from Saul. So all the elders of Israel came to the king at Hebron, and King David made a covenant with him at Hebron before the Lord. They anointed David king over Israel. David was 30 years old when he began to reign, and he reigned for 40 years. At Hebron, he reigned over Judea for 7 years and 6 months, and at Jerusalem, he reigned over all of Israel and Judea for 33 years. And David became greater and greater, for the Lord, the God of hosts, was with him. The word of God for the people of God.
Thank you very much, Kevin. I hope that it made sense to you, because today's text stretched over decades of time, starting from when he was a young boy all the way to becoming a king and reigned. But anyway, this is a week 5 of this Week Enough to Lead series. So like Mr. Steve said, last Sunday, we looked at Saul, the first king of Israel. And we learned that between his personality flaws and the circumstances of the time that he lived in, things did not quite go well as the people had expected. Using the Reverend Dr. James Howell, the author of this book, from the very beginning, poor Saul was pretty much done. That's hard, but that was the reality for him. But the story of God's people Israel, and the king continues despite that failure. Again, Dr. Howell affirms, with David, God begins to use their foolish request for God's higher purpose. So today's main character is David. So how do you perceive David, like described in simple words? Brave? Chosen? Great warrior, powerful king, or selfish, self-serving? I always had a not-so-great impression of David. I think it is because my Old Testament professor at my first seminary, he said what he said in class like 20-plus years ago. He said something like, David was like the last person you want as your neighbor, because he would eye on whatever he wants and take it from you. Yeah, I don't like to have a neighbor like that. So, and to me, whenever I think of David, this character comes to my mind. Do you know who this is? Anyone? Everyone? I hope so. Yeah. Especially when he was at the very beginning of the movie. He was young, talented, but arrogant and self-serving. In case you didn't know the movie, he's a race car. He's a rising star kind of thing. But he thinks that all the success was achieved by his talent alone. And he disrespects and mistreats that his fellow team members. But after he got lost out of nowhere and meeting a bunch of simple yet caring people, he starts to recognize what really matters in life. Being surrounded by friends who care, being grateful towards those around you, and helping one another, thus to live the best life. David's saga began when one day Samuel came to his house. Samuel was in fact looking for a next king, just as the Lord told him. He went to the house of Jesse. So Jesse tallied all the boys up and lined them up in front of Samuel. Samuel passed by one by one by one, but God dismissed him all. He could not find the one that he was looking for. So Samuel said to Jesse, the father, "Is that all of your boys?" "Well, there still remain the youngest, but he's out keeping the sheep. Well, bring him over. I am not going to sit down and eat until I see him." So David was brought in, and then God said to Samuel, "That's the one. Anoint him." So Samuel did, and of course, text that we heard. From that point on, the Lord's Spirit came over David from that day on. So whether he was aware of the significance or what it meant, it sure was a life-changing day for David. But the question becomes, why God chose a shepherd boy in the first place? Well, we have an image like towards shepherd, like a poor, lowly, and despised. We kind of talked about that a lot of times, you know, especially that during the Advent when we talk about the shepherds coming to see the Jesus. But when we looked at the Moses story a few weeks ago, I quoted Dr. Howell that actually, although we often have negative image towards shepherd, but their work actually require considerable administrative savvy, because they had to tally and care for tens of thousands of flocks. And Dr. Howell actually continues this way, quote, "David was a shepherd boy, but his responsibilities to care for the flock, ensure they got food and water, protect them from harm, and bring them safely home, those were identical to those of the good ruler." End of quote. He was the youngest, and perhaps the weakest. His job was taking care of the sheep. But God knew David by name. God knew his personalities, his gifts, his weaknesses, his heart, his faith, and the possibility of who he could become. And God chose him to be the king. It was a prime example of small enough or weak enough to lead. Well, one event or another, David rose up to the throne. He was what Peter Drucker, who is a well-known consultant, would call a natural. Someone with confidence who effortlessly inspires and understands priorities. Yes, as long as David remembered what the priority should be, he was successful. For example, remember the story when he fought Goliath? When he was in front of one of those giants, this is what he said. "You come to me with sword and spear and javelin, but I come to you in the name of the Lord of hosts. The Lord will deliver you into my hand so that all the earth may know that there is a God in Israel." So he was very clear about who he was and to whom he belonged. And of course, he was successful and he was able to beat the giant and gave all the glory to God. So things were great as long as David remembered where his priority needed to be. But on the other hand, David's infamous infidelity with Bathsheba, it revealed a danger. When a leader's strength abused, weaknesses unacknowledged, and when a leader loses sight of God and God's call for his life. Remember the responsibility of a good leader I just quoted to you a minute ago, are to care for the people, ensure what they need, provide what they need, protect them from harm, and bring them safely home. But in this particular instance, David and Bathsheba's story, David did just the opposite to Uriah, Bathsheba's wife. Husband. So that all the things can be covered up. Remember what he did? He made an order to put Uriah, the husband, in the hardest battle, on the very front of the hardest battle, and the rest of the troop will retreat so that make sure that this man will be killed in the battle. See, David lost the priority, his call, his purpose, and acted selfishly. And it was not pretty. Fortunately for David, there was Nathan, the prophet, who would not be afraid to tell the king an honest and hard truth. You may recall the story when Nathan confronted King David. He will tell a story. This man, rich man, who had many livestock, he was so stingy that he did not want to kill any of his the sheep to entertain his guest. Guess what he did? He went to this poor man who only had one sheep, who he brought as his own daughter. Remember having heard that story, David was furious, and he said to Nathan, "This guy is bad. He should be killed." And remember Nathan's famous word? "Guess what, king? You are that man. You are that rich man who took one sheep from this poor man." David admitted his fault. He repented. And he confessed that he had walked away from God. Well, Nathan said to him, "You know, your life will be spared because you repented, but your child who are to be born will die. And also there will be always a family feud in your house," and which was the case. Despite his weaknesses and flaws, or because of them, David lived a life filled with turmoils and drama. He messed up from time to time, but we like to believe that his faith was genuine. Despite the mistakes that he had made along the way, he strived to live a life of faith, serving as a spiritual leader for God's people, Israel. Towards the end of 2 Samuel, David's last words are recorded as follows. "The Spirit of the Lord speaks through me. His word is upon my tongue. one who rules over people justly, ruling in the fear of God, is like the light of morning, like the sun rising on a cloudless morning, gleaming from the rain on grassy land. So in short, David was a man who was unexpectedly chosen by God. From that day on, when Samuel came to his house and anointed him, his life was never be the same. He was not always perfect. We looked at that. In fact, from time to time, he missed the mark and suffered the consequence of his missteps. He had experienced challenges. He lived with grief and disappointments. Yet he lived his life the best he could, in his time and the place that was given, striving to fulfill the call that God had given him for his life. Think about it. In our own unique ways, we are all like David. Well, don't get me wrong. Not all of us might rise up to become the world leaders, CEO of the Fortune 500 companies, or top military commanders. But our purpose in life is the same as David's, fulfilling the special tasks that God has for us, living out our faith in the time and space that we are living, in order to further advance God's kingdom here on earth. In our own unique ways, we are called to care for the people around us, ensure what they need, protect them from all the harm, and bring them safely home. God needs each of us. The world needs each of us. At the same time, we need God. And we need God to be the priority of all we say and all we do. And we need one another in the journey. Well, Dr. Howell, the author of this book, in this chapter focusing on David, he mentions this concept called extraordinary gesture or grand gesture. So as I close today, I'd like to share that with you. What he means about saying our extraordinary or grand gesture is that what he means is an action, which may be a simple act, yet lasting, world-changing impact in a grand scheme. And he uses an example of Danny Meyer, who's a restaurant entrepreneur. He used to say to all his managers, "I encourage each manager to take 10 minutes a day to make three gestures that exceeds expectations and take a special interest in our guests." That would translate to 1,000 such gestures every year. See, it doesn't seem like a lot. 10 minutes a day. Do three things for three different people each day. And Dr. Howell actually says, a grand gesture or extraordinary gesture might be as simple as a telephone call, showing up unexpectedly, or being gracious when the opposite is expected. Can we also do that 10 minutes, three person a day, of extraordinary gestures? Could be a smile, could be a hug, a note, phone call, whatever you do in the name of Jesus, so that the impact might go much farther than you might think it is. Well, as for Mr. McQueen, He too found what really matters in his life. Having friends who care about him and help them out in return. In the end, he realizes life is not a one-man show, but we are living together. We are called to live together and journey together. So may we also remember the same. May we be thankful for all the friends who love and care for us. And may we help them in return. And always remember, life is not a one-man show, but we are called to live and journey in faith with others, so that in our own unique place and ways, we might be able to fulfill the call God has for each and all of us. Thanks be to God. Amen. So today we're able to come together to the sacrament of Holy Communion, one of those special times when we're able to see, taste, and touch the grace of God. So as always, we like to begin with the prayer of confession, that we might be able to come to the Lord's table with clean and right heart. May we pray together. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we are yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Glory to God.
Amen.
So now I'd like to continue with the great thanksgiving, and the responses are on the screen. The Lord be with you.
Also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift up
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right
and a good and a joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Almighty God, Creator of heaven and earth. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy are you, and blessed your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And when the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciple, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." And so these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here in all this gift of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory, and we feast at his heavenly banquet. through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. Body of Christ, for all of us, people of God, in the blood of Christ, the cup of salvation to us all. So now I'd like to invite Heather, our lay leader, to come and assist me with the grape juice. So what it is, we have small pieces of bread, and she has the individual cups of grape juice. Thus, we will receive the body and the blood of Christ. Please note that United Methodist Church practices open communion, which means all God's children of all ages and all walks are invited to receive the grace of God. So now, if you are ready, if you would just come, and you are already here, so now we'd like to receive the gifts. Prayer. Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Amen. So now I'd like to invite all of us to stand if you are able, and may we sing together This closing hymn today, My Faith Looks Up to Thee. If you'd like to read it with the music notes, it's 452 of your United Methodist hymnal. Please stand as you're able and join in singing. Guide you and always give you peace. Amen. Thank you.